If you look at the night sky, you walk away from the city, there are no clouds, and your eyesight is really, really sharp. You may be able to see an image of stars and galaxies like this one. This is actually a deep field image from the Hubble Space Telescope, which has been orbiting around Earth since the 90s. Tremendous progress has been made since Galileo first pointed a telescope to the sky. We now use radio wave, infrared lights, visible lights, X-rays, gamma rays to know what we do about the universe around us. And so we can zoom in and look at the structure of galaxies. And we know that the universe, it's the sky out there, is not a quiet place at all. There are violent events that are happening all the time. Stars collide, stars explode. There are black holes that suck everything that's around them. There are, however, still many questions that we don't have answers to. We don't know what is all the matter that composes the universe. We know that there are black holes, but we don't know exactly what they are. We don't know exactly how stars explode. So there are still many unknowns, including what happened at the very beginning of the Big Bang. New problems that we're going to have to find new ways and techniques to solve. And this is where my research comes in. Gravity is at the core of the theory of general relativity. General relativity was formulated by Einstein 100 years ago, so last year was the anniversary, to explain gravity. Einstein was not happy with the concept of gravity as Newton introduced it. He was not happy with just saying there is a force between any two objects, so the sun attracts the Earth, and that's why the Earth is rotating around the sun. He wasn't happy that there is no, classically, we didn't know why. What is the messenger that carries the information of how planets and stars attract other bodies? So Einstein had a new vision, a new way to explain gravity that's not in terms of forces, but in terms of the geometry of space. So according to general relativity, two objects are not attracting each other because of a mysterious force, but because they're moving in a space that is not flat, it's curved. So according to Einstein, this is how Einstein would see the universe in a two-dimensional representation. So the universe is not flat, it is curved by heavy objects like stars, heavy planets, all the way down to a black hole. So you see in this image the planets and are producing some curvature in it. And so the reason why the Earth is moving around the sun is because it's moving on a curved surface. And if you look very carefully all the way to the back, there is what looks like a funnel. That's a black hole in general relativity. It's a bending of space-time that is so deep that it almost punches a hole in the fabric of space-time. And so that's why matter and light cannot come out of it, because they're moving down this funnel. So that's how black holes are introduced in general relativity. If we now think about two heavy objects, like two black holes, so in this representation, you see those two whitish blobs. Pretend they're black and call them black holes. And think about these two objects orbiting around each other, like in this animation. So as the two objects are moving around each other, they change the way they're curving space-time around themselves. And so as they do that, they produce these ripples, these waves that you see in this animation, that propagate outwards. It's a little bit, think about when you throw a rock in a pond. You're disturbing the surface of the pond, you're producing waves, and the waves propagate outwards. The same thing is happening to space here as these two heavy objects, these two, again, let's call them black holes, are rotating around each other and they're producing ripples, waves that propagate away. Now, space is a very stiff medium, so it takes a lot of energy to perturb it and produce these waves. And so that's why when Einstein 100 years ago calculated it, the back of the envelope calculation of how strong an effect it is, he decided it was going to be impossible to ever measure it. It's going to be too hard. Well, he was wrong on that one. On February 11th, this year, on February 11th, the science team that I am privileged to be a member of announced the first direct measurements, the first discovery of gravitational waves that were produced by the collision of two black holes. So I'm going to show you here an animation. This is a computer simulation of what happened 1.3 billion years ago. So what you see is the effect of two black holes that are rotating around each other. And as they do that, they bend the way the light coming from the stars behind it propagates. And so you see this effect, this motion of what looks like the motion of the stars. That's not something that we can see. And so you see now the two black holes have merged, and we're left with a single black hole. We cannot see the light coming from that, but what we can see is the gravitational wave that was produced as these two black holes inspired and then eventually collapsed. And so this green streaks in this video is the gravitational wave that was produced. It goes farther and farther until the moment the two black holes merged. And then you see the ripple that propagates away. That's the last moment, the moment of the merger, and that's when most of the energy was produced. And then it started propagating through the universe, through space. It modified space and time. Fast forward 1.3 billion years, and it reached Earth. And it reached Earth on September 14 of 2015. And so as you can see, that's the effect that the gravitational wave had on Earth as it came by. It's that wave produced a wobble in Earth. That wobble is actually a very exaggerated effect. I didn't feel that. You guys did not feel that. The only way to sense something like that is to have a super accurate instrument. Just to give you a sense of the scale of this, what you saw produced, so the echo of that event that took place 1.3 billion years ago, it was equivalent of changing the distance between Earth and Alpha Centauri, which is the closest star, by the thickness of an hair. So it was that small an effect. So measuring this is what Einstein thought was not going to be possible. But it was possible to do it thanks to this detector that's called LIGO. So LIGO stands for Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. What you see here is an aerial picture of the detector that's in Washington State, in the desert in Washington State. We have a similar detector installed in Louisiana, so closer to here. And this is an interferometer whose arms, so the length of those arms is 4 kilometers. So I'm going to show you in an animation what is the operating principle for LIGO. So the basic idea is to use lasers, laser interferometer, to measure the difference in the change between two mirrors that are 4 kilometers apart. So the idea is that we get a laser beam, we send it against a semi-splitting mirror, we split it in two, the light travels in the two arms, gets reflected, comes back, recombines, and then we set things up in such a way that the light coming from the two arms interferes destructively, so we get no light coming out, they cancel each other. As the gravitational wave comes through, it moves the mirrors, it changes the distance between the mirror and the beam splitter, and it does so alternatively in one arm and in the other one. And as it, does that, you see that the phase between the two light beams changes, and so we get, on that screen over there, we get a little bit of light that comes and goes, it pulsates with the frequency of the gravitational wave. So by monitoring that spot very carefully, we can measure changes in the length of those 4 kilometer arms, and then we use that to track the passage of a gravitational wave. And we expect that that happens both in Louisiana and in Washington State in the same way, and that's how we recognize it's a gravitational wave. Just to give you an idea of how small an effect this is and why this is so difficult, I'm going to show you here how the effect that we're measuring compares with the scale of an atom. So as I said, those arms are 4 kilometer long. The level of the changes, the movement of those mirrors, is 4 × 10⁻¹⁸ meters. So how small is that? So this is just to give you a scale, is the representation of an hydrogen atom. So the red trace is the electron, the blue is the proton, which is the nucleus of the hydrogen. And so now we're going to zoom in. Yes, here we go. So this is the electron moving around the nucleus. So the size of that nucleus is 10 to the minus 10 meters of the atom. The nucleus is 10 to the minus 15 meters. And we go, and the effect that we measure is of the order of 4 10 to the minus 18 meter. It's that small. It's that small a measurement. And so that's something that requires a high level of engineering and planning in order to be able to do that measurement. So that's why this discovery of gravitational waves is actually what's most impressive to me is that this is really something that builds from a vision, and it developed all the way to the collaborative work of 1,000 people to its realization. So 100 years ago, Einstein first had this vision that we can use geometry to explain gravity. He had this crazy idea of a curved space-time and a space that ripples, and he just saw that, and he used math to write it down and to make the prediction of gravitational waves. It was about 6 years later that those three gentlemen, Ray Wise, Ron Driver, and Kip Thorne, took that idea, that concept of something that Einstein was non-measurable, and actually came up with a design and an idea for a detector. So Ray Wise was the first one to, in 1972, formulate, with this historical paper, formulate the idea of using laser interferometry and these techniques I described to you as a way to detect gravitational waves. Ron Driver built the first prototype, a much smaller version of the detector that I showed you before, and came up with some of the techniques that are still used in LIGO itself. Kip Thorne was the theorist who really advocated the possibility of using astrophysical sources to measure gravitational waves. And so he did all the calculations of what kind of signals we can expect and theorized ways to solve some of the many challenges that LIGO has to face. Because to make such an accurate measurement, we need to have a very precise instrument that can fight lots of possible noise sources. So in the middle row, you see pictures of the two detectors, LIGO in Louisiana and in Washington State. And in the middle, I apologize, the pictures are a little bit small, are some of the snapshots of how complicated actually the instrument really is. To realize those, we needed a collaboration. So in this corner picture over there, you see some of the logos for the members of the collaboration. So I'm a part of the LIGO Scientific Collaboration, which includes about 1,000 members across 8 institutions in 16 countries. So this is now a worldwide effort. So there was a vision, there was the potential for a realization, but then in order to bring this to completion, we had to really have a cooperative effort brought together by many brilliant scientists and engineers that had to learn how to work together towards this common and very challenging goal. And that's part of the beauty of this discovery, beyond the discovery itself, is also how these 1,000 people had to learn how to work together towards a common goal. And then in the lower corner, you see an image of that first detection. So we call this event GW for gravitational wave, 15/09/14, that's the date, September 14, 2015. And what you see, those traces as you see there, those are three lines that are overlapped. So the more wiggly one, the blue and the green and the red, that is the data that was measured in the two detectors in Louisiana and in Washington. And those are simply overlapped and shifted by a little bit. So that signal happened with the same feature, the same wiggles, within 7 milliseconds, which is consistent with the fact that this signal came from the lower hemisphere and reached the two detectors 7 milliseconds apart. And then on top of it is the prediction of general relativity. So this signal that we saw is matching very, very well with the prediction of general relativity for a signal that's coming from the inspiral, the merger, and eventual relaxation of those two black holes, this cataclysmic event that took place 1.3 billion years ago and then reached us. So I want to play for you what this would sound like if we take that signal and plug it into a speaker. Now, I want to be clear, gravitational waves are not sound waves, so we're not really listening with our ear. However, this stretching and squeezing in space-time is something that we can put into a speaker and listen to it. So you're going to now hear the final yelp of those two black holes that 1.3 billion years ago collided. And you're going to hear it four times. One is as it sounded, and then it's shifted in frequency so you can hear it a little better. And then I'm going to do it again. So what you just heard is the final cries of these two black holes as they merged. If you think about it, this is phenomenal. We have just opened a new way of listening to the sounds of the universe. This is like having a new sense, a new way to perceive the universe. It's like the first time Galileo pointed his telescope. It's a new window that we have opened on the universe. And this is what's most exciting to me. We have confirmed the theory of general relativity. We have confirmed that gravitational wave exists. We have also discovered that black holes that are about 30 times the size of the sun existed. We were not really sure about that. They were only theorized. And now we know that we can use these signals to understand more about the properties of black holes, for instance. And we're going to use them to do a new type of astrophysics that we call gravitational wave astrophysics. We have a new messenger that's carrying information from the motion of matter that happened billion years ago. This event took place as life on Earth was just starting to form. And 1.3 billion years later, we could just hear it. We're now listening to it. So this is a momentous window opening. It's a new opportunity. The tracks have been laid thanks to the work of those people with the vision and the 1,000 scientists who made it possible and realized. And now that the tracks are laid, I'm looking forward for what the ride will hold for us. Thank you.